shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month, at even, from even unto even, shall ye celebrate your Sabbath. Father God, in the wonderful name of your Son Jesus, speak to us through your word. O Lord, bless us by your grace with obedient hearts to obey. Let me speak unto us. O Lord, thank you for the atonement and the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for covering us. In the wonderful name of Jesus, amen. You may be seated. Just for a few moments, I want to speak on the subject of be covered.
Unless somebody tells me
that I haven't done. Now, all of my years in, my younger years in church, maybe only a few times I can remember where the preacher even talked about the feast of the Lord and appointments with the Lord and keeping the appointment with the Lord. So I didn't even know I had an appointment. And so I miss celebrating and acknowledging the appointments with the Lord and miss out on many blessings. So how many of us in the church today have missed out on so many of blessings because we miss the appointment? And so here in chapter 23, the Lord is telling them about the feast of the Lord. And when I'm just going to jump right into it again. When we get to verse 26, the Lord is telling them, the Lord spake unto Moses. So in your leadership has to hear from God. So if leadership doesn't know, and if leadership is without knowledge or ignorant, how can you then give instructions to the people when leadership is in ignorance? So if there's something that I'm in ignorance of, I don't have knowledge of, have understanding of, how can I communicate the mind and heart of God to you if I don't know? But if I don't spend time listening to the Lord, how can I hear what he has to say to his people? Now, that's why I tell people, please read and meditate on with your scriptures yourself. I've always been the type that I'm going to read the word of God for myself. If I don't understand it, I'm going to pray, Lord, please give me understanding. There were things that I were not taught by spiritual leadership, but because I spent time in scriptures myself and prayed to God, the Holy Spirit unveiled things to me. So when he unveiled things to me that my leadership didn't know, then I would ask questions, what is this about? Sometimes they would go, I'll be back with you. And then I go back to the Lord, like, well, Lord, this is what you said, but my leadership said, I'll be back with you. So I need you to help me. But because I sought the Lord, he said, if you will seek, you shall. If you ask, it shall be. If you knock, it shall be. So what I'm trying to tell you is value leadership, but seek God for yourself also. Don't become so dependent on leadership that you don't spend time with God. There are too many people heavily dependent on leadership to tell them something, but they miss out on spending time with God. Now, I love God. I love spending time with God. I love praying to God. I love seeking God. But I want you to have a healthy, intimate, personal relationship with the Lord yourself, just in case if there's something that I missed this for that I haven't tapped into. You have a God that knows all things, that is everywhere, that is all powerful, and can communicate to you. We become so dependent on man. And yes, God has graced and gifted men of God and put them in position to feed you the word of God, but we are never, ever, ever to replace your intimate relationship with God. We are to supplement your relationship with God and help to get you to know him on a greater level as the Holy Spirit has graced us, but we are not your God. I keep telling y'all this over and over and over again because there's some people sitting here right today who are hurt and offended because a man that you put in the place of God has disappointed you. And now you have run and went away from God and are mad at God just because man disappointed you. But God never, ever has there been either with the other thing. But we honor leadership, we respect godly leadership, and Moses was a man of God that talked to God face to face as a man would his friend. And because he spent time in the presence of God and received from God, he was able to give the people of God what God gave him. Now, if your man of God doesn't spend time in the presence of God, it's a problem. Every day, I dedicate at least, I would have two hours at least, spending time with God, talking to God, listening to God, because if I don't, how am I going to communicate with you? I spend time praying for you. I wear out a lot of shoes on prayer walks. I do. I go through shoes. They just split. I remember one day I was walking, and when I lifted up my foot just went all the way up. It just split. But I was putting in old work. I was putting in spiritual work. Amen. Prayer walks, talking to God, listening to God, praising God. Praise should just start when you get in here. Praise is anywhere when you think about what God has done for you. When you think about how he's preserved you and kept you and blessed you and fed you and healed you and saved you and delivered you, he's increasing you. Are y'all happy here? Yes, yes, that you wake up to another day, and with that new day is new mercy. Amen. And his compassions fail not. Amen. Even though you were disobedient yesterday, yet he let your eyes open to this day. That shows that God is loving and is kind and he's merciful. And when my desert's old, saying goes, when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, my soul cries. Hallelujah. Yeah, this is happening. All right. Yeah. I'm going to stop right there because I'll start thinking about it and I'll be happy right here. I'm going to preach. But, amen. But when I see Toya, I want to go, hallelujah. When I see Mother Barbara, I say, hallelujah. Yeah. When I see Rosalind, I say, hallelujah. Why? Because they were all the same man, but God brought them up. So I told y'all I have to. But when I think about, see, I don't have to just think about what he has done for me. If I think about his goodness towards you, I can be encouraged that if he's good to you, I know that I will experience his goodness for me. There are many people, because the Bible says, weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who are rejoicing. But if I can get happy for what he has done for you, then I get the benefit, the overflow. God, I'm giving from the text, but that's okay. You can give from the text if you give him praise and you give him praise. Yes. But I'm going to tell you all one of my secrets. One of my secrets to get encouraged when I'm going through is I pick a person and simply by God's grace, he's gifted me a certain way so I can take a peek in your life to see what God has done. And I peek and I go, Jesus. Because what I'm doing is I'm using my spiritual cheat sheet. I might be going through a test, but if there's already the answer or testimony in you, if you've been through the test already and you passed by God's grace, why shouldn't I take the cheat sheet?
That's right.
A testimony is simply, I came through by the grace of God. Really, a testimony is a cheat sheet of what God will do for you in the same situation. Oh my God. Oh my God. So I'm just focused on spiritually. Find a cheat sheet. Find someone with a testimony or the witness of the goodness of the grace of God.
Cancel out the judgment that is supposed to come my way.
Thank you, Lord.
Moses, I'm going to cover you on this day, but this is what I'm going to need you to do. This is an appointment. Don't miss your appointment. He said, this is going to be a holy convocation. Meaning, holy means that set apart, consecrated convocation, which means a convocation means assembly. So when we come together, it's a holy assembly. Meaning that when we come together, we're going to understand that we are covered. Maybe y'all are not happy. If you're in here and you're in this holy convocation because of the Lord Jesus Christ, you're covered. You're covered. You come, that's why the Bible says, forsake not the assembly of yourselves together as the manner of some as you see the day approaching. Don't miss your appointment. Don't miss the holy convocation. Now, yesterday, I don't watch as much sports as I used to because I prefer spending time with the Lord. I prefer to listen to men and women of God who preach and teach the Word of God. So my interest now is more spiritual than it is in the natural. Because the Bible says, look up for thy redemption, draw it now. And I know if I speak, I feed my spirit man more than I feed my flesh, then that's the man that is going to be strongest. I remember a time when I would watch football from the time that the first game came on all the way through midnight because there were people on the West Coast still playing. And so I was feeding myself more of natural stuff than I was spiritual stuff. And I found out that I wasn't thinking about God as much as I should have been because I was thinking about worldly things. But now since I know the Lord Jesus Christ, I enjoy spending time thinking about things that have concern with him and his kingdom. How many of you spend more time thinking about God and more time with the people of God than you do with the people of the world? Now, at some point, we need to reach the people of the world, but I would rather congregate and assemble with you. I'd rather assemble with you than go to a football game or a basketball game or a cookout. I would rather be amongst the saints praising and worshiping God and thanking God, seeing the miracles of God, seeing the power of God, experiencing the presence of God, to be with heathens who do not know him, who are not thinking about him, unless I'm witnessing to them, or even showing them the love of God. Y'all don't seem too excited. But I would rather be in a holy congregation with the assembly of the saints, but where two or three are gathered together, there I am in the midst. I'd rather be with you because I know God is manifesting.
I know I'm kind of loud, but I'm excited. Tone it down, turn it down. As you're about to breathe, thanks for being with those who do not know God. There's something about being in the Holy Assembly amongst the saints that gets me excited. I'm a bust if I try to keep the same. I feel like Jeremiah. I feel like fire. I'll show up in my back. I'm sorry, y'all. I have to turn my mouth back up because I can't be quiet. I feel like Jesus when he was going to Jerusalem. If you try to shake them up, the rocks will cry out. Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. He's going to crack the staff. Right on a right staff. All his lives shall be revealed, faithful and true. Are y'all with me? I can see it right now. He's coming back for me and you. He's coming back for the saints. Oh, I'm not worried about what's going on in the world. These are signs that he's coming back. The trembling of the earth. The overswelling of the seas and the ocean, the floods and the rain, the lawlessness, the slack of judgment and mercy, a sign that he's coming back. Now calm down, y'all. I get too excited with you. Well, I wouldn't want to listen to someone. And how are you going to tell me about something that you're not excited about? How are you going to tell me about a God that you don't love that you're not excited about? If you're excited about it, it makes me excited. You got to afflict yourself. Yeah, you don't sound to be sound. You're like, Pastor, that don't sound good. Now, I don't want to do no harm to myself. I'm okay mentally and emotionally and otherwise in relationship. I don't want to harm myself. You want to for the Lord. Because you are causing yourself harm though you don't know it, because you want to afflict yourself for the Lord. I'm going to explain it to you. To afflict yourself means to depress yourself, or you and I need to pull away from the table and fast. We need to humble our soul. Fasting is a humbling of the soul, meaning that you and I put the soul in check and not give the body what it wants. And the reason that soulish and bodily appetites are just crazy, nobody's behind you. See, when you start talking like this, everybody shrinks. They look down, kind of look away. Please not talking to me. Please talk to someone else. I don't want to appear as though I'm the one who is extremely carnal, have struggles or fetishes that I don't want anybody to know about. So I know Pastor is not talking to me. He's talking to her. He's talking to him. But he couldn't possibly be talking about me, because I'm in Jesus. We're good. It says I'm in Jesus. I'm good with the Father. So I don't know what he's talking about. You are super spiritual and carnal, and you are in delusion. And you and I need to get our flesh in check. And we do that by fasting, and to make it cry like a baby who wants a bottle but you don't give it the bottle. Like a child with teeth who needs to come off the bottle because it's mature, but when it doesn't get the bottle, it screams and screams and hollers and praying at you because it's trying to get your attention, to get you irritated, to get it what it wants, so be quiet down only for a moment. So he said, this day, since I'm covering you, I want you to afflict yourself. I want you to depress yourself. I want you in fasting, because if you are not fasting and pulling away from the table, if you're not keeping your mind on me, during your appointment, you're going to be so concerned about you that you're going to miss meeting with me. How many of you have missed an appointment with the doctor or with someone else because you were so concerned about doing something that was pleasurable, but you wanted to appease yourself that you missed your appointment? I remember my sophomore year at University of Georgia. I was in basketball courts, and the game was good. The game was good. Y'all know, the pastor was on fire. The jumper was on point that day. The crossover dribble back behind the back. It was like, and people were like, oh, gee, that was a nice move. And I got caught up because I got in pride. Okay, maybe I never played sports anymore. But you know, when you hear ooh, and I'm like, ooh, gee, you shook him. That means that he was supposed to follow me, but he went another way, and I look back and laugh at him while I laid the ball over. But it got so good that I looked at the clock and said, I got a little bit more time. And since I was playing so well in the through the legs and behind the back spin move, everything looking good, and all of a sudden, I looked at the clock, and I was past my time for my class. And I needed the vital information, I'm telling on a college student, for that class to take the test.
All right.
So I missed my appointment to gather knowledge, so that when it came time to take the test, I was taking the test in partial ignorance. That's how the people who boosted me up on the court, who got me in trouble and got the big head. What I'm trying to tell you is, don't be so concerned with you. but you miss your appointment with God. Now, he says here, I need you to afflict your soul in an offering made by fire unto the Lord. There needs to be an offering. And that offering would have to be the offering that the Lord requires. Not you giving and not I giving us what we want to give him. What does he require? Alright? And he says, you shall do no work in that same day, for it's a day of atonement, an atonement for you before the Lord. So this day, all work was supposed to stop. Because it was supposed to be a day of rest where you are thinking about the Lord and about him covering you and atoning for your sins. Now, how many people put work before God? I'm guilty. Maybe I'm the only one. Let God be true. And every other man a liar. Now, so what God is saying is that I am the one who gave man work anyway. So when I say stop, you stop. I want everything on pause. Now, I know that they're hyping up climate change. Now, even if we were affecting the climate so much, if we actually obey what God says to do, the environment won't be a problem. The problem is, since we do not honor and respect God's word and what he tells us to do, we're even affecting nature. And then there are people who are purposely affecting nature. Y'all catch that? I'm speaking in code, parables, if you want to do the mysteries of God. But if I tell you don't work this day, rest, don't work. Why? God wants you to rest while he covers you.
Yes.
I'm going to say that again. Why should I work if you're going to cover me? I'm going to say it again. God say, I got you. Rest. That should make you happy. I don't want you to try to figure it out and work it out yourself. Rest. I'm going to cover you. This is a day and a season and a time that I don't want you to work. I will cover you. This is what I want. You've been trying to figure out, Lord, I'm sick, I can't get back to work. You're not supposed to work on this time. I'm atoning you, I'm covering you, I'm catching out things that could kill you and destroy you and take you out. I want you to rest. I will cover you. You can't cover yourself. You're not without sin. You can't cover your own self. You need me to cover you because you can't pay for your own sins. A person who is a slave cannot buy themselves out. They need a kinsman redeemer. They need what the Hebrew says about all, meaning that when God stepped in and became a man, he stepped into humanity, into our kin or our likeness, so that he could cover us. Come on, y'all sit down. I'm getting excited. Now, oh, they're in trouble. They're getting excited with me. Now, look. Don't do any work, for this day of atonement to make you atone for you before the Lord your God. That means that you are in trouble with the Lord. Now, look how good God is. Oh, my God. You all, I've never seen it this way. God is so good that he says, you're in trouble with me for breaking my rules, but I'm going to cover you. You sinned against me and offended me and dishonored me, but I want you to rest while I cover you.
Y'all did me wrong. Y'all were disobedient. You dishonored me. You don't respect what I said. But rest while I cover you. So why are you going to try to work when I'm working and you cannot mend and reconcile your relationship with me by your words? But if you have faith in resting in faith, I will cover you and take care of what you did not do to appease me. So the only one who can appease me is me. So I'm going to go down there myself to appease me up here. I'm going to say it again. I'm going to leave from down here because only I know what it takes and what I want. So I'm going to go down and do it myself. But in doing it for me, I'm only helping you. But because I love you and want fellowship and communion with you, I'm doing it for me, but I'm helping you. Oh, God is so good. It don't make sense. Whoa. Pay attention. I'll get you a sign. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in that same day. Alright, so if you don't want to depress yourself, if you don't want to fast on this day, if you don't want to humble yourself, you don't want my grace. The Bible says that God gives grace to the humble. He said, so if you pick yourself, you're humbling yourself, and what it says is that you want my grace. I'm going to say it again. So if you don't want to affect yourself this day, what you're saying is, I'm going to stay in dishonor and disrespect to you, God, because I'm going to do what I want to, even though you said grace and affect yourself, and I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to do what I want to do, and that means that you will not receive God's grace. I don't even know what you're going to do with that. But this is what God said I'm going to do. I'm going to cut you off. So you think you're going to do what you want to do and then come back and get with this holy convocation? These people who have separated themselves, put their minds on me, humble themselves before me. You think you're going to get with them and say hallelujah, but there is no grace to cover you? Oh no! Oh, you'll be raising your hand saying hallelujah, but you're a goat, not sheep. You're weak, you're tear, but not weak. And it may appear that you're holy, but you're unholy. It may appear that you're productive and you're weak, but you're not. You may look like a sheep because early on you kind of look like, but then as you grow, you go to your head, open your butt. And at some point, we'll be able to tell that you're a leader. When your talk is not bad. And when I speak to you, my sheep know my voice. He didn't say go, he said, my sheep know my voice. Goats do whatever they want to do. They eat whatever they want to eat. You put paper down, the goat will eat paper. But sheep have a very tender digestive system. They have to be on a specific diet. They like fresh grass. Fresh revelation from the Word of God.
He's talking.
Yeah, maybe we're wrong. I'm getting excited.
cut you off. Yeah. Now, have you ever been cut off in traffic? Oh yeah, I'm hearing some exquisite language on my left hand side. You got cut off, and all of a sudden your vocabulary got extensive and deep. And what was hidden up under, what you thought was a lot of spirituality, that tapped in to an area that gave you access to language that was not of the Holy Spirit. And it was not for edification, exhortation, and comfort, but it was for to let the person know, I don't know why you let your window down with your automatic windows. And gave them a gesture, did not say that I love you, but it said something else. But repent, because of the day of atonement you come. If you rest in the finished work of Christ. just so I let go, Lord, it was me. I repent. I'm sorry. The Lord, they needed to get somewhere before I did. Bless the Lord. I learned to say, no, I'm only going to eat my testimony on my cheat sheet. When people cut it, I said, oh, Jesus, bless you, bless you, bless you. Yes, you. Yes, you. Yes, you. That's the way you want to go. Bless your heart. If you're ever talking to me while I'm on the phone, you know, I have an earpiece in and you hear, bless your heart. Oh, bless you, Lord Jesus. Did you bless you? That means someone has cut me off. And the Bible says, blessed and cursed not. Don't allow anything unwholesome to come out of your mouth. Except for that which is for edification, exhortation. You covered. You covered. Now he said, what shall your soul be that doeth any work on that same day? The same soul will I destroy from among his people. Could it be? Could it be? In the soulish realm, there's destruction and perishing going on. Because we are missing our appointment and we're not obeying the instructions of the Lord. And he said, if you don't do this, your soul will be destroyed. Your soul is your mind, your heart, your will, your intellect. There's a struggle in the soulless realm because instead of it being about God and focus of God, it's all about you and possibly all about me. And we're not doing what God is saying to do. On the day of atonement, the appointment day, when we're supposed to humble ourselves before the Lord, the Bible says, I will keep thee in perfect peace whose mind is staying on thee. I want you to rest while I cover you, but you keep trying to do life on your own by yourself when I got you covered, but you keep progressing and want to do your own thing, and you destroy your soul, your emotions are out of whack, your thoughts are unending and they won't stop because you just continue to work yourself. When I say rest while I cover you. He said, do no matter work. It should be statute forever throughout your generations in all your dwellings. I'm going to say it again. It should be a statute, an ordinance forever throughout your generations. Forever means that it is perpetual.
Yes. Amen.
Yes, we're not under the law, but we still have to obey the principle that God set for the day of atonement. Are you hearing what I'm saying? This is why. The feasts are an appointment where a portal is open for you to experience what God has for you. But a portent with your doctor is a portable time where you get to meet with him so that he can help you through the knowledge that he's gained through his school. On a feast day, a feast time is an appointment with God where you have a window of time to meet with him so that he can help you in life. In whatever you need help with concerning salvation and covering your sin. Notice he said, forever throughout your generations. So why are we not acknowledging what the Lord has done? Now, earlier, I told everyone who came in, from 6 o'clock this evening to 7 o'clock on Monday, we will be fasting. We will be spending time in prayer. Water only. From 6 o'clock this evening until 7 p.m. on Monday evening. We will be fasting water. Now, if we do what the Word tells us to do, we should get the results of what the Word says we will get the results of. If you afflict yourself, if you depress yourself, if you fast during this time, if you humble your soul, you and I will experience. We're like, Jesus has already died and arisen. We don't have to do that, Pastor. He said it shall be a statue for it. The Old Testament, the shadows, the New Testament, Jesus fulfilled it. But he said, I still, forever, I will meet with you on this day. On this day, this is when decisions are made about the rest of the year. If you participate in this, it's really an acknowledgement, Lord Jesus, we acknowledge that you were our offering. Your blood atoned for our sins. And really what it will do, some of you walking in condemnation, it's going to help you remove condemnation off yourself because you're realizing that Christ has covered you for all your shortcomings, all your mistakes, all your struggles is covered, and you'll stop working and you will rest in the finished work of Christ. Verse 32 said, it shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and you shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month at even, from even to even shall you celebrate your Sabbath. Now, last month I went on vacation. And every night since I came off vacation, I'm still dreaming about Panama City, Florida. Amen. For some reason, I still see myself walking on the white sandy beaches with the clear ocean water from clear to blue to amethyst color purple. And I'm like there in my dream, I feel it. And in my dream, I'm not going to be in a hurry to come out of that dream. I feel the water hitting my feet, and I hear the water, and I just go, oh, yeah. I get to take a vacation every night. Don't have to pay for it. I mean, every night, at a part of the night, I go on vacation, and I experience the beach. And I wake up, I was like, I went there again. Oh, bless y'all so. I'm sorry that you want to go on a vacation and my dad doesn't get your budget. I'm sorry. Don't get in the spirit. God will give you a prepaid vacation because Jesus said it is finished. I'm going to say it again. I'm sorry for you that you don't get to go on vacation every night as I do. And you don't get to experience the water and the beach and the waves and the beautiful water and the white sand. I'm sorry for you. Then the Lord gives me prepaid vacations. And I just rest in it every night.
for how long he allows me to be there. But Jesus said, it is finished. Meaning it's paid for. I'm sorry that you're not resting in the finished work of Christ, and you keep overworking your mind and your body and your soul and your outer life, physically, emotionally, spiritually, and relationally. Why don't you just receive what Jesus has done for you? The finished work on the cross, on Calvary's cross, on Golgotha's hill, when he hung for our sins and all the sins of the whole world were placed on him, and he became our sin offering, our prayer offering, and the Father judged him for our sin. And he did it willingly. And after he finished paying for our sins, he said, it is finished. It is paid for. Now, I want to tell you, if you receive and you rest and stop working, if you rest in faith in what Jesus has done and stop working to try to be good, because you cannot be good. Because it's not by works lest any man should boast. By grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves. Now, if you accept this prepaid, everlasting, eternal vacation, where your soul rests in Jesus, one day, you'll be able to stand before the throne. And I know Panama City has beautiful water, but at the throne of God, there is a stream and flow of water that is crystal clear, where you will be able to see it flow. Y'all ain't get happy with me. I'm waiting for the day that I'm before the throne, and that water that flows before the throne is flowing in front of you and I. There is nothing that can defile that water. We don't have to worry about climate change. We don't have to worry about any more storms and earthquakes and sinners and lawlessness and all the people who can do evil. Because there will be no one in the New Jerusalem that does evil. They will be without. Y'all know what I'm saying. Now, will you rest in what the Lord has done, or will you try to work it yourself? The Lord wants you to rest because he's finished the work. He wants you to rest in the finished work of Jesus Christ, so that you can rest from toil of trying to do it yourself, which will never appease the Father. He will only accept the finished work of Christ. Our day of atonement. In the day of atonement, the high priest can only go in the Holy of Holies once a year. If he went in there any other day, he would drop in. So they would tie him with a rope, and he would have bells on, pomegranates, so that you would know he was alive and he's moving around here. Oh, he's still alive. If you ever stopped hearing the bells ring, they would just pull the rope. You're dead. Next up, who's the next high priest? And he would go in with the blood, all right, of sheep and goats, and he would sprinkle the blood seven times over the mercy seat.
Yes, sir.
Which was over the Ark of the Covenant. In the Ark of the Covenant, there were the tablets of stone of the Ten Commandments, manna that was rained down from heaven, Aaron's bud that budded to show who is the true priest and who has authority for God to serve in the tabernacle. He could only go in there once year, and he would do this every year. When his life ended, another one was chosen to serve as high priest. They kept doing this over and over again. The blood
of bulls and goats, the Lord had no pleasure in them. They could cover, but they could not take away the impact what the sin did on your conscience. But Jesus, not only was he the Lamb of God who shed his blood for the remission of our sins, but he is also our great high priest. And so goes the high priest, so goes the nation. If the high priest dropped dead in the Holy of Holies, that means that the sins of the people were retained for a whole year. How would you like for your sins not to be forgiven for a whole year? How would you like to be in depression and heaviness and anxiety and fear all year over what you have done? But Jesus, our high priest, went in, not only carried his own blood as the pure, spotless Lamb of God, but that blood could not take away what your conscience was feeling, because they are a different species. To cover human beings, you need blood of a human that is not tainted with sin. That's why he was born of the Spirit of God, because your Father determines your blood type. And if God is your Father, you're holy, your blood is pure, your sacrifice is for human beings to cover the human species. And that's why Isaiah 9:6 says, guess what? His name is called Wonderful Counselor. Come on, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, the Everlasting. So he is now the Father of the human race, meaning that the God type. John 1:12 said, as many as receive him, to them gave him power to become the sons of God. Now he steps in and says, Father, all along those were just types and shadows, but a body thou hast prepared for me, that I might do thy will, O Lord. You really wanted a kinsman redeemer to redeem the Adamic family out of the slavery of sin. And guess what? Here I am. I was a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Here is the blood. Not in the sanctuary that is down below, because he is not from the tribe of Levi. He's from the tribe of Judah. But guess what? He's after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus. So now, look what he does. The Levites were Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, because it's a higher priesthood. So he stepped into the heavenly sanctuary with the blood. That's why he told Mary, don't touch me. I have not yet ascended to my Father. I have to go present this blood to my Father and say, now I covered them, forgive them, I reconcile them back to you so that they be your sons and daughters. We can be one family. You and me, I in them and them in you. Now we're one again. Now they have peace with you. So any who obey you and rest in this finished work, now you can be presented before the Father and be accepted in the beloved Jesus Christ. Now you have peace with God. God is not mad with you. God is happy and joyful that you receive his Son. Because if you receive him, you receive the Father. Oh my God. Now he's happy. Now when we say the blood, what we're saying is, I'm covered, my sins are forgiven. I have peace with the Father. Oh my God. Now, all he wants us to do is acknowledge and celebrate the Day of Atonement. It is a reminder how he covered us, how he forgave us, how he sent his only begotten Son to die on the cross and pay the price for our sins. To be resurrected, which signifies that we are now justified before the Father, receiving light in the face of God. If you'll stand, I pray that this word has given you understanding.